Faribault.
They're unbeatable.
Faribault.
The greatest dual meet team Minnesota has ever seen.
Faribault.
18-0, on their way to the championship.
Faribault.
They've beaten Apple Valley, Albert Lee, Anoka.
Faribault.
Rated number one in every poll all season long.
Faribault.
Nobody could touch them.
Until that most memorable of all days, of all matches in Kennedy wrestling history, St. Paul Civic Center State Wrestling Tournament.
It was a time of reckoning, of colliding with an unmovable force called Bloomington Kennedy. What happened? The team that everyone had said would win it all didn't.
Faribault learned what it means to take on a team with unstoppable determination and a secret weapon.
Landon Haggard. Welcome to the match that more than any other we can think of showed the stuff that Kennedy wrestlers are made of. And this was that fateful match that turned the tide back in Kennedy's favor. After dominating in the lower weights, the team had just barely been able to hold on to a tie through the 185-pound match.
Coach Aarons told Haggard before he went on the mat that all he had to do was tie, and the Eagles would win by criteria. That is, we could have won 6 matches to Faribault's 5, thus giving us the victory if Landon tied.
When we got through the most agonizing 45 minutes any Kennedy fan ever went through, and the officials finally declared the match in our favor, the team went crazy.
And Landon? Well, the big-hearted freshman who had shown so much poise became an instant hero. In one of the most exciting matches in state tournament history, our secret weapon had come through.
This team, so rich in tournament experience, so determined to beat the odds, so believing in themselves, had done what nobody in the media had thought possible. Nobody who was there on that day in early March will ever forget how unbelievably good we felt at that moment.
Important as it is in Kennedy athletic history, that match alone didn't make a whole season. Let's review what went on as we worked our way to another unblemished season record and another Lake Conference championship.
When that Lincoln match was over, it was official. For the fifth straight year, that Kennedy team had swept up the Lake Conference Championship. We celebrated that night, but in a very special way. Recognizing the imminent closing of Lincoln, mothers and friends of Kennedy wrestlers, including Helen Taylor, Peg Wickland, LaVon Berklow, and Mrs. Brown, organized a post-match get-together for Kennedy and Lincoln wrestlers, parents, and friends.
Green and white mixed with blue and gold that night as old friends got together. A prelude, really, to what will happen next year when we welcome half of Lincoln's student body into the school.
Before we leave the regular season and move into tournament action, we need to step back for a few minutes to a weekend in January when it was colder and windier than we ever thought possible. Worthington gave us its usual warm welcome, complete with 103 below zero wind chills and a blinding blizzard. You couldn't see anything when that wind blew.
Of course, it didn't matter much, because there really wasn't a whole lot to see in Worthington when the wind stopped. For the fifth straight year, Kennedy was in town, intent on leaving its mark on the Worthington triple duel.
And before the tournament was over, it would be clear that once again, Kennedy was a team you didn't take lightly.
That weekend wasn't the time of just lying around.
We came ready to wrestle, just ask Justin.
With just the right tunes going through their heads, the team was all psyched up.
Talk about being prepared. Chris had been to Worthington before. He knows what it can be like down there, so he made sure he had protection, even where his trapdoor opens.
Time to wrestle. The action that weekend found Kennedy taking on a stubborn New Ulm team in the first round.
The level of competition was high, and that was good for our team, for it gave everybody a chance to sharpen up on some skills and to show what they could do. Here's a guy who won't forget Dave Wickland.
David showed why he was ranked top in the state in his weight class all season long. Kennedy's strength was too much for New Ulm. Kennedy came out on top 32-21.
Then came Osseo, a team that would give Kennedy a run for the money in the state tourney.
This time around, Osseo found itself struggling to keep alive when faced with some pretty solid Kennedy wrestling.
Again, Kennedy's class came through in the face of respectable opposition, and Kennedy came out on top once more, 30-19.
In the match that would determine the championship, a state-ranked Worthington team was ready for the Eagles. While a raging blizzard shut down the town, a raging Kennedy team put the clamps on Worthington.
The match stayed tight, however, and it took a lot of skill and determination to keep us ahead of Worthington and to give us that tournament trophy.
Finally, it was obvious that Kennedy was going to do what it had done five times before.
Win the tournament and sweep the individual awards.
With only marginal opposition in the late conference to challenge them, it was good for the team to be able to prove themselves that they indeed could win against some pretty respectable competitors at this excellent tournament.
While the rest of the world was huddled away hiding from the blizzard outside, the Kennedy delegation found its way through the storm to Michael's restaurant. Not even the blizzard of the century was going to stop them from celebrating with everything they wanted on the menu
and off.
Oh, watch out, Jeannie. Older men can be dangerous, especially that older man.
Back at the motel, it was time to get casual and make a few new friends. Anybody we know? Tom and Jeff?
Chris decided it was time to show the upperclassmen a thing or two about underclassmen, while other guys got down to some serious game playing.
Finally, it actually happened. The guys got tired and called it a day or night.
And contrary to what everybody thinks, a group of wrestlers actually can be quiet in a motel.
Except for an occasional snore from some really accomplished sleepers in the group. Notice that nobody wanted to sleep with Jeff.
The next morning, we were supposed to leave for home, but the vans wouldn't start, and the freeway was closed anyway. So it was time to call home and let them know we were staying another day and night. What? Would that mean a day off from school?
Time to really celebrate. Who cares if it's a million below outside when you've got a pool and lots of guys to maul? Watch it, Tony. Those disposable suits don't hang together very well.
Osseo was marooned at the Holiday Inn with us, but they evidently had had enough of Kennedy, for they never came around when we were spending a nice, quiet, friendly afternoon in the pool.
Coaches Todd Ahrens and Charlie Vavrosky thought they'd stay away from the mess in the pool by hiding in the sauna.
Their escape didn't last long, however. It did take nearly the whole team to get the best of Charlie, nevertheless. Though we don't know if he ever really did get dunked. Todd became the next victim, but he didn't prove to be an easy mark either.
The girls tried to remain above it all. They weren't going to get into that mess. Brian, you should have listened to the girls. That disposable suit of yours didn't stay on so long as we remember.
Chris thought he was going to stay nice and dry.
But he found out different.
Megan, too, naive child that she is, actually believed that she wouldn't get thrown in, but Megan proved to be just too tempting of a challenge. She really looked tempting afterwards, too. Say, Megan, what was that you told us about blow-drying your bra? One should always have a change of underwear along at Worthington, you know.
Later in the day, everybody sort of settled down and had a relaxed, good time together. Jeannie must have been lonesome, however.
There was nothing lonesome about the cheerleaders. Nice body, Heather.
Yes, this was a very good weekend for the group. Good friends became even better friends. There were brothers there, like Tony and Tracy.
And brother and sister, like Michelle and Chris.
And then there were these buddies. Bruning evidently likes having Brayette's tongue in his ear.
Well, we couldn't stay in Worthington forever. At last it was time to pack up and leave that winter paradise. Robin was all rested, and it was time to go.
Of course, that depended on getting the van started. On that Monday morning, we were luckier than the owner of this car. Of course, the coaches had taken turns getting up all night to start the vans.
We got all of our things together and headed out to load up. Most important, of course, were those trophies. Kennedy had taken all the hardware for varsity and junior varsity.
Reluctant as they were to end their weekend isolation with 40 high school students, these people did consent to get us back on the road again.
And we headed back to Bloomington, dodging snowdrifts on the freeway and getting by Albert Lee just before the freeway was closed down again. Indeed, we had left our mark on Worthington, and a couple of us left our marks on the vans as well. Whose buns match up with these window impressions? Troy? Blake? Tony?
Ah, yes, but the best of all, we were coming home with trophies that helped to build our confidence. We were a team, a good team, and we had proven that we could handle other state-rated teams.
We were on our way. Now let's take a look at the individual wrestlers that carried Kennedy's phenomenal record of success into a fifth straight season. Starting us out is Marty Morgan, an exceptionally talented eighth grader who's been around wrestling about as long as he's been around.
He's the fourth of the many mighty Morgans. Dan, John, and Gordy have been ahead of him. And Marty has benefited by the experience of those brothers. That's obvious when we look at his varsity record, 10-5-1, and realize that after placing fifth at the Shakopee Invitational, Marty still went ahead to finish high enough in the conference to merit all conference honors.
Chris Lembeck, though only a sophomore, Chris has earned more honors already than most high school wrestlers even dream of.
In his third year on the varsity, Chris again showed that he deserves the top state ranking that was his all season long. This three-time all-conference wrestler was the champion at the Shakopee, Worthington, and Stillwater Invitationals.
He forged his way to his first region championship, then dominated the competition to finish first in the state tournament individuals at 98 pounds. His record? A perfect 33-0, bringing his high school career record to an amazing 78-6-1. Chris Lembeck, wrestlers and team members don't come any finer than this young man.
And now, another wrestler who has been a major Kennedy force for so many years, Justin Berkelow. This very talented senior wrestled at 119 and 112 during the year on his way down to 105 for tournaments. This all-conference wrestler dominated the competition at the Shakopee, Worthington, and Stillwater Invitationals. Along the way to an outstanding 28-4-1 record and a region 6AA championship. Justin Berkelow, he'll be hard to replace, for he's done so much so many times for Kennedy wrestling teams.
And now we have Steve Brayette, another highly talented sophomore, whose performance this year proved that his years of wrestling experience make him someone to be reckoned with. Steve wrestled at 119 and 112, winning championships at the Shakopee and Stillwater Invitationals.
He wrestled in a tough weight class at Regions and finished in third place. His record, 21-10-1, We're looking forward to many excellent matches in the coming years from this outstanding young man.
It's with great pride that we now look at Blake Bongine, another of those first-class wrestlers that have helped to make Kennedy a state power during these years. Wrestling at 126 and 119, this three-time all-conference wrestler was the individual champion in his weight class at the Shakopee, Worthington, and Stillwater Invitationals.
In Region 6AA individuals, Blake was the runner-up. He won a silver medal at the state tourney at 119 when he placed second. His 28-1 record this year boosts his career record to an amazing 82-12. All the more impressive when we realize that Blake still has another year of high school wrestling to go.
Another Morgan, Gordy this time. This freshman wrestled junior varsity most of the season, but he was brought up to the varsity during the first part of February after Blake injured his knee.
Gordy's varsity record was 4-3-1, but all Gordy will remember about his time on the varsity was tying region champ Andy Rindell of Wayzata in the team regionals. You couldn't have found a happier wrestler than Gordy Morgan that day.
At 126 and 132, we have a skilled junior, Jeff Jones. Jeff has proven to be a scrappy, determined young wrestler, and this year he won a championship in the Shakopee Invitational during a 14-7 season.
No doubt the high point of Jeff's year was when he won a second-place medal in Region 6AA individuals, thus qualifying him for state individual competition. A solid wrestler all season long at 132 pounds was Kennedy's Tom Bruning. While earning a 15-13-2 season record, Tom won a championship at the Stillwater Invitational.
And in region individuals, Tom finished in third place behind some really outstanding competitors. Tom Bruning, only a sophomore, he'll be back for two more seasons of good Kennedy wrestling.
Though Joel Rudd started the year short in experience, by the time it was all over, he had grown into a varsity position and had become a valued member of that team.
He started at 132 and went to 138 to fill a problem position at that weight. While earning an 11-9-2 record, Joel placed third in region individuals. He shows the kind of determination and spirit so essential to good team wrestlers.
Next, we have senior Tim Evervold. This 145-pounder was riddled with old and new injuries that kept him to a 9-5 record. A persistent knee injury slowed him down. Then came a rib injury suffered in the Como Park meet.
Frustrated at being sidelined, Tim nevertheless continued to be an enthusiastic team supporter, and we were really pleased for Tim that he had a chance to wrestle in the state tournament against Osseo.
Here's the first of two from this family, Tony Wadding. Tony has been in wrestling for many years, and he capped off his high school career with an excellent performance in the state tournament. When Tony thinks back to his senior year as a wrestler, he won't remember his 14-15 record nearly as much as his excitement in getting the team crucial points in his 9-8 decision against Faribault and his major decision against Brainerd.
Wrestling first at 155, then at 145, Tony proved to be a wrestler who came through when it was so important for the team.
John Sherritt. John had a problem few wrestlers ever do, being heavy enough for the competition. Normally a 145-pounder, John had to fill slots ranging from 155 to 185 pounds. He had to be held out of practice many times so he would be heavy enough to weigh 158.5 pounds, the minimum for a 185-pounder. The highlight of his season was an 8-3 win over Matt Jury in the region individual tournament.
Of all the outstanding wrestlers that have made Kennedy Wrestling what it is today, Dave Wickland ranks among the very finest. First on the varsity as an 8th grader, David has amassed a record during his 5 years as a Kennedy wrestler that's nothing short of overwhelming. This 3-time all-conference competitor instilled fear in wrestlers all over the state, first at 167 pounds, then dropping to 155 in February.
Name a tournament, Shakopee, Worthington, Stillwater, and David was the champion in his class. He also rolled to yet another Region 6AA individual championship, thus qualifying for the third time for state individuals.
That's where Dave suffered his only blemish on his 33-1 record. Despite an obvious case of the flu and a knee injury, Dave came back to win the state third place medal. Dave rewrote Kennedy Wrestling records with the most career wins, 98, The best win-loss record, 98-18-3, for an average of .8361. The most career near falls, 178, and the most near falls in a single season, 71. Co-captain Dave Wicklund, a wrestler who can do it all.
Giving additional strength to the upper weights was the other wadding wrestler, Tracy. Normally a 167-pounder, Tracy spent most of the season at 185 pounds. He was an excellent competitor at those weights as he posted an impressive 25-5 record.
Tracy won individual championships at Shakopee, Worthington, and Stillwater, and in Region 6 AA individuals, he finished in third place. Tracy was counted on to bring in key points match after match, and he was appreciated as a co-captain whose leadership on and off the mat made him so valuable to the team.
There was no doubt that Tracy was a positive influence on his fellow teammates, and skill-wise, he was also first rate. Coach Aaron says that technically, Tracy was one of the best mat wrestlers in Kennedy's history.
Finally, the wrestler whose efforts told the story of the state tournament, Landon Hagert.
This outstanding freshman heavyweight showed poise and determination as he earned a 17-12-1 record. He finished as runner-up at Shakopee and champion at Stillwater, and he'll long remember a third-period pin of Lincoln's highly rated Mike Tettner. Still, that Faribault match looms as the most significant to not only Landon, but the whole team.
Wrestlers alone don't make the team, however. There are other very vital people who help to make things function, like the scorekeepers, Megan Ahrens, Elizabeth Berkey, Jeannie Pribble, and Michelle Lembeck.
These girls perform so many essential duties that we know we'd have a hard time keeping the program functioning smoothly without them. Not only did they do an excellent job of scoring each match, they were also our most loyal built-in fans. They put in so much time and contributed so much emotional energy to the cause that we can't imagine having a program without them.
In that crucial Faribault match, it was their exacting scorekeeping that helped us to offer a solid defense when those around us were trying to say that we had not tied in Landon's match. Our scorekeepers, we think they're a first-class group of girls.
Another group that we have really appreciated and enjoyed has been the cheerleaders. Over the years, the cheerleaders have learned to understand wrestling so much better, and now we think our cheerleaders do just an excellent job of following the action on the mat and knowing what cheers would be most appropriate to give and when.
These girls were, of course, with us at Worthington, as well as all the other matches and tournaments, including the big ones at state. We appreciate their loyalty and dedication, and we know that the whole team was a better team because of the high caliber of cheerleading support these girls gave.
Then there are the coaches, starting here with Chuck Bevrosky. Where do we find such world-class coaches? We think the finest wrestlers we know have come through our own program, and Charlie, of course, is one of them.
He was a state champion and a university wrestler himself, and this year he was able to share his knowledge and expertise with us. Back again for his fifth season of coaching was another top-flight coach, our own Dana Thompson. They don't come any more dedicated, loyal, skilled, or energetic than Dana. We're hoping Mad Dog Thompson can be back again for another year.
Coach Ahrens, that's Todd Ahrens, of course. Todd also was a Kennedy wrestler and a state champion. And this year, Todd joined our coaching ranks and helped to teach our wrestlers what he has learned during his many years as a championship wrestler. Todd was one of those fine wrestlers who came through our program when things in Kennedy wrestling were starting to boom.
And here's another Ahrens, Patrick. Pat has been the Hopkins Eisenhower coach for a few seasons, and during region individuals, it wasn't unusual to find Pat, Todd, and Dave all coaching on one mat, though for different wrestlers, of course.
Now a minute about Coach Dave Ahrens, the architect of Kennedy's incredible string of wrestling successes. All we have to do is to look at his record over the last five seasons to understand the caliber of coach that this team is blessed with. 102-7-1. What more needs to be said? He's the best there is, and he's right here at Bloomington Kennedy. He cares, he appreciates, he inspires, motivates, and teaches. And the results he has had show that he certainly knows what he's talking about.
And who's this coach in the stands? It's Pete Berkey, who coached for a few of our state tourney years. Pete flew in from his job in Connecticut just to be at state with us. Loyalty, it runs all through the Kennedy Wrestling Program, past and present.
Well, now that we've looked at the competitors, coaches, and support personnel that made up this fine team, those were the people who carried our colors into region competition.
Once again, Kennedy hosted the individual and team tournaments, and wrestlers and other students helped to provide the manpower to make the tournaments function.
Chris entered individual competition at 98 pounds, defeating Wyzetta's Sonnenstahl 16-1 here in the semifinals, and Robbinsdale's Baker 6-5 in the finals, to win the region championship and a berth in the state individual tourney.
At 105 pounds, Justin beat Cooper's Rice 7-1 here in the quarterfinals. Then in the semifinals, he beat Miller from Mound with a fall at 2 minutes 55 seconds.
In the finals, Justin defeated Rodzian of Lincoln 17-2 for the championship. Justin was on his way to state.
Steve, at 112 pounds, went through an especially tough weight class in individuals. He lost in overtime in the quarterfinals to Street of Minnetonka.
Then in wrestlebacks, beat Dworsky from Mound 6-4. Followed later by this match for true second with Labatt from Wyzetta. Steve lost this one 8-2. That ended a bloody series of six matches against some outstanding competitors.
At 119 pounds, Blake dominated challenger after challenger. Mound's Vierling probably has nightmares about being pinned here in the quarterfinals.
Despite a knee injury, Blake was the dominant power on the mat, no question about that.
Orono's Arnie found that out here in the semifinals when Blake beat him 12-2. Because of concern for Blake's injured knee, he defaulted in the finals. Finally, he had to wrestle Ravis of Minnetonka for true second. Blake won 7-5, and he too was headed for state.
At 126 pounds, meanwhile, Jeff Jones was working toward a state trip of his own. Here, he's beating Nelson of Armstrong 3-2 in the quarterfinals. Then, in this nerve-wracking semifinal match, Jeff beat Wyzetta's Gleason 4-2 in overtime.
Then Jeff lost 6-4 to Jefferson's Kranz. He finally had to win a state berth by beating McDougall of Tonka 3-0 to finish as the true second.
Tom Bruning at 132 beat Orono's Meyer 12-6 in his first round here. Then, against Buffington in the semifinals, Tom rallied to pin the Armstrong wrestler in an emotion-packed match.
In the finals, Tom lost to Richfield's Jakubiak 10-7, followed by a loss to Jefferson's Hoyland 7-1 for true second. Joel Rudd entered the competition at 138, here defeating Elder of Richfield 6-1 in prelims. Then in the quarterfinals, he defeated Groen of Robbinsdale 7-0 in overtime. He was sidetracked in the semifinals, however, by Cooper's Rolls 6-4.
In wrestlebacks, he pinned Eisenhower's Kirsten in 3:15. Finally, for third place, he defeated Jefferson's Oliver 5-4. The chance to finish as the true second fell short, however, when he lost to Tonka's Groutman 8-2.
Tony, at 145, beat Cessery 7-0 in prelims, but then lost to Tonka Svensson 5-4 in a tight and disappointing match. In wrestlebacks, he defeated Richards of Orono 7-2 in overtime. Then he lost twice, first to Cooper's Waste and finally to Elton of Lincoln.
David, meanwhile, was the controlling force all through the competition at 155. Here, Dave was on his way to a pin of Cooper's Pressman at 437.
This semifinal round finds David working for a first period pin of Richfield's Holt.
A defeat of Schletty of Jefferson for the championship meant David had just won his third Region 6AA first place medal. He was going to state. Tracy worked his way through the 167-pound class, here defeating Mounds Bixby 15-6 in a very convincing match.
Next, we have him here in the semifinals, beating Robbinsdale's McGinty 8-2. In the finals, Tracy lost to Jefferson's Vermilion 5-0, followed by a heartbreaking 7-5 loss to Richfield's Hansen for true second.
Wrestling well above his weight at 185 pounds, John Sherritt was overpowered by Wyzetta's Lyle in the prelims. In the first round of wrestlebacks, he beat Jury of Jefferson 8-3. Here, John took on Robbinsdale's Pitt, but he suffered a pin.
At heavyweight, Landon pinned Jefferson's Burns in the second period, only to lose in the quarterfinals to Sneddon of Robbinsdale 10-3. In this match in wrestlebacks, Landon defeated Mounds Schaffner 8-7. Two more losses found Landon finishing in sixth place.
Despite all the extremely tough competition the team faced in region individuals, the boys still came out as the overwhelming favorite for team competition, over 50 points ahead of second place Jefferson.
And the next weekend, the top four teams would battle it out for the team title. So it was that it was our time to take on Wayzata in the semifinals. Chris started out our first match with a pin.
Justin kept the momentum going with a decision at 105 pounds. Then came Gordy's excellent match, a tie with region individual champ Andy Rindell. Gordy couldn't stop smiling after that one.
There was never any doubt as to what Blake was going to do. He did about everything he could do, short of a pin, winning 18-2. That brought the team score up to 16-5.
Then came a good match for Tom. He came up with a 7-2 decision and a little advice from Coach Thompson after the match as to how he could have done even better.
Determined to make the best contribution that he could to the match, Joel went out onto the mat psyched for a win, and win he did, 11-1. The team score then went to 23-5.
Then came a tough match for Tony that ended with a 5-4 decision.
David came back with another of his overpowering Wickland pins at 155, followed by yet another pin by Tracy at 167.
Finishing off the match were a loss at 185 and a heavyweight pin by Landon. The score was 41-14. We then watched closely to see who we would meet in the finals. When Jefferson lost unexpectedly in the semis against Minnetonka, the action then got underway once more as Kennedy went after its fifth straight region championship.
Chris and Justin set the tone for the whole match when they got quick pins.
Not to be outdone, Steve went after a second period pin of his own in a match that showed just how skilled he really is.
Gordy had trouble with his man, and he lost in a decision. Blake came back with a pin, however, making the team score at that point 24-3.
Tom then struggled to a 10-10 tie at 132 pounds.
Joel followed with yet another tie at 2-all.
We gave up 3 points when Tony lost the decision.
David stretched out the point margin with a 13-2 major decision.
Tracy added more points with a pin, and Landon finished off the match with a decision.
And they had done it again. There was no doubt whatsoever that Kennedy, with a 41-16 score in the region finals, deserved to be hailed as the region team champions. That was a night of much-deserved pride for a team that was that had again dominated the conference and the entire region for the fifth straight year.
So here we were, back at stake for the fifth time, with five individuals entered in individual competition and a team that was determined to work toward the championship.
We had heard the gulps when people had found out who we would be facing in that first round, Faribault. If you read the newspapers, you would have seen that Faribault was picked by literally the whole state to finish on top.
As well we know, that wasn't what Kennedy wrestlers believed, however. Supported by the biggest and most enthusiastic crowd that has ever followed us to state, we were ready to sidetrack the big green machine.
And that crowd went wild when Chris started us off with a first period pin. We knew that if we were going to have a chance to win, we would have to be strong in those lower weights. Spirits kept soaring when Justin then won 7-3.
The huge Faribault crowd kept silent when Steve then won 2-1. And Kennedy was out ahead, 12-0. Faribault had never been down by so many points all season long. And what did we do next?
We increased their misery and our excitement when Blake added yet more Kennedy points by winning 11-8.
Our fans knew they were witnessing wrestling history in the making, even as we lost the next three matches and the score edged closer together.
Just when Kennedy was getting a little apprehensive, Tony won probably the most memorable match of his career, 9-8. He became Minneapolis Tribune picture material with that win.
David raised the team score to 22-13, and then the tension became unbearable. When Tracy and John lost, the score went to a 22-all tie.
Enter young Landon Haggard, a wrestler who didn't let a little thing like having the entire world on his shoulders slow him down. If he could at least tie, Kennedy would win.
He faced a tourney veteran, a senior who on paper should have smothered Landon, but he didn't. Landon kept fighting back. and when that tension-ridden match was over, he had forced a 9-all tie.
We had won 6 matches, so we knew that we had the team tiebreaker. A mistake in the official scorebook delayed our final joy for 45 minutes, but in the end, it was Kennedy that would advance to the semifinals.
The lesson that day, don't believe what people tell you is going to happen to you. Make things turn out the way you believe you can.
That night, we followed our individuals in the competition, where Chris won his first 2 matches. Justin won his first, but got sidetracked his second time out on the mat. He then went into wrestlebacks.
Blake started out strong at 119 when he won his first 2 matches. His second match came against Faribault Smuda, a guy who had a grudge to settle if ever anyone did. Blake further frustrated Smuda and Faribault, however, by beating him a second time in the same day.
Jones entered individuals in the 126-pound class, but he lost out in his opening round. We were apprehensive when David had to wrestle that night, for he had a bad case of the flu. He managed to win the first match, but we all realized that the David Wicklund we knew wasn't the wrestler we had then watched lose in that second round.
The next day in wrestlebacks, Justin's mom and dad nervously watched as he won 1 round but lost out to Rodvik of Mankato in the next. A disappointed Justin Berkelow had his heart set on placing, but that wasn't to be. He then had to turn his attention to the team match that night.
Jonesy, too, was disappointed that afternoon when he lost out in wrestlebacks. Then we watched as a rejuvenated Dave Wicklund showed us just how terrific we knew he could be when he won 18-1 and 11-1 in his 2 rounds that day.
That night, a wild and crazy Kennedy crowd was all primed for yet another breathtaking team match. This time against a team nobody had thought much about, Brainerd.
Their enthusiasm, however, was dampened when right from the start of the match it was obvious that things were going against us. We'd counted on a strong start from Chris, but a first period head and neck injury left him dazed. He did force a 14-6 decision, nevertheless, but we were all a little shaken.
Even wrestling diehards like Mary Hovey here were getting nervous when Justin then followed with a tie. This wasn't the way things were supposed to be going.
Then Steve lost a decision, putting the team score at 6-5. Things were to stay tight all the way through.
Blake gave us back some confidence when he won 18-6, even though he re-injured his knee right at the very beginning of the match. We wondered for a few moments if he was going to be able to wrestle, but he was, and he won.
Then Jones lost a major decision, tightening up the score 11-9, with Kennedy still on top. Brainerd was showing the tournament that it had been a team underrated when it had come to St. Paul that week.
Our anxieties increased, then, when Tom and Joel both lost and Brainerd was ahead 15-11. Then Tony had another of his outstanding state tourney matches by winning a major decision 12-4. That put the team score back to a tie, 15-all.
And Tony was a pretty happy wrestler when he claimed victory that night.
When John was pinned in the next match at 155, Brainerd soared ahead 21-15.
David then came back with a 12-2 major decision, and Tracy followed with a superior decision, 18-4. That put us ahead 24-21, and put the pressure right back on Landon. After being down 5-0 to start the third period, Landon rallied for 4 points, but he ended up losing 5-4.
Brainerd pulled into a 24-all tie and won the same way we had won against Faribault the night before on criteria. The irony couldn't have been stronger.
That night, we were anxious about Chris and his neck injury when he went out to wrestle in individual semifinals. Chris didn't let that slow him down, however, as he proved to be dominant once again, winning 6-3 over Mankato's Andre Harnitz. Chris had worked his way into the state individual finals.
Blake's knee slowed him down somewhat, but not enough to stop him from beating Alexandria's Doug Johnson 6-2. A very determined Blake Bongean had also fought his way into the state finals.
Then came the team's match for third place against Osseo. We had beaten Osseo at that Worthington tournament in January, 30-19, but we knew that Osseo had come on strong later in the season. Chris opened with a 4-0 decision, followed by Justin and a major decision at 105.
Steve kept the momentum going with a 7-0 decision, paying back Todd Bowerly for a loss at Worthington.
And a very happy Gordy Morgan then made his contribution to the state tournament by winning 9-2 at 119.
Blake then won 7-4 to put the team score at 16-0.
Things slowed down then when Tom lost a decision, as did Joel. Osseo was on its way to reeling off 23 straight points, and the tension mounted once again.
John was one of the casualties, as was Tim at 155. Tim was filling in for Dave Wicklund, who was being checked by doctors at the time to see if he would be able to wrestle at all that day in wrestlebacks. Dave had injured his knee and was forced to sit out the team round. Tracy won his match 13-6, and then Landon, the tourney marvel, got a pin in 57 seconds to give Kennedy a 25-23 win.
There was no doubt that this team's 5 years of state tournament experience paid off this year. We weren't awed by what we faced. Instead, we were confident that we could hold our own.
That confidence paid off when, for the fifth time, Kennedy won a state trophy, thus making us the only team in Class AA competition to place at state 5 years in a row.
It was a very happy group of wrestlers and coaches, joined by scorekeepers and cheerleaders, who took center stage that day at the Civic Center. Medals were received with great pride, that's for sure.
Later, the doctors let David continue in individuals, and in the finals for third place, Dave got his revenge by beating Rosemount's Wilcox, the wrestler who had knocked him out of the championship bracket earlier.
Dave Wicklund, a state champion last year, has showed a lot of determination, the hallmark of a Kennedy wrestler, when he overcame his earlier disappointment to win four more state matches and yet another state tournament medal. Congratulations, Dave, on a job well done.
In his championship match, Blake lost a heartbreaker 9-8 to Gleva of Rosemount. Even so, Blake had finished the year as the state runner-up with a silver medal, and that's no small feat.
We don't think anybody's going to want to wrestle Blake next year, for we know Blake is going to be going for gold. Blake Bonjean, state runner-up.
At 98 pounds, Chris faced Baker of Robbinsdale in the finals, just as he had done in the region finals. This time, too, Chris came out the winner with an 8-5 score. Chris Lembeck, the state's top-ranked 98-pounder, had his name up in lights when he won his gold medal.
It was a very proud moment when his mom and dad joined him for this victory portrait. Chris Lembeck, state champion.
Everybody connected with this team felt a surge of pride as we watched Kennedy do what so many teams only dream of doing. Once again, it's been an exceptional year to be a Kennedy wrestler, cheerleader, or a Kennedy fan. Right, Mr. Olson?
The next day it was time for a little relaxation and celebration. Everyone gathered at Wicklund's, where a sign proclaimed the tradition of excellence this team has developed.
The cheerleaders brought the team a cake with their message of support.
And Coach Ahrens did his best to eat his way to dessert early so he could get the first piece.
In fact, everybody made eating his first order of business. After so many months of watching what they ate, of always wondering what the scale would say the next morning, the team looked over a great table full of all kinds of good things and then proceeded to pile up their plates and then to fill up their shrunken stomachs.
The mothers provided a great victory feast that day. While at school during Spirit Week, our California Dreamin' wrestlers, Tim and Dave, accepted a congratulatory cake from Mr. Kessler on behalf of the team. That cake celebrated all the good Winter Kennedy teams, foremost of which was this state tournament wrestling team.
Memories, that's what we're left with now. Memories of a season based on tradition, packed with emotion, and rich with accomplishment.
The wrestlers on this team have learned their lessons well. They know what it means to sacrifice, to struggle, and even to suffer.
They know that nothing worthwhile comes easily. You have to work for everything you get. You have to put yourself on the line and risk losing if ever you are to win. It takes a lot of character to understand that, and that's what separates Kennedy wrestlers from so many other athletes who never quite measure up.
Character. It's there in our most valuable wrestlers. This year we have two. Certainly their accomplishments, individually and on behalf of this team, support the choice of Dave Wicklund and Blake Bonjean.
And our junior varsity MVP choice, Gordy Morgan.
Certainly this year's outstanding wrestler deserves his award as well. They don't come any more outstanding than the state champion, Chris Lembeck.
And for the JV, once again, Gordy Morgan. For leadership, the choices again are obvious. Could there have been finer young men leading this team than captains Tracy Wadding and Dave Wickland? We don't think so.
And on the JV, the leadership award goes to Todd Thoma.
Now the coach's award to a young man who exhibits so much of the good that we like to see in athletics. Congratulations, Tracy Wadding. And congratulations, too, to the JV recipient, John Sherritt.
Now, for most improved, the hero of the Faribault match, and a wrestler who came so far in a single year. Congratulations to Landon Hagert.
And for the junior varsity, most improved honors go to another outstanding young man, Mike Walsh.
And for caring enough to want to be the very best, we congratulate an entire team of fine athletes. They outscored their opponents by a total of 516 to 182. They continued a record of dominance unmatched by any team in any sport in the conference, region, and state.
Kennedy Wrestling, a sport where athletes are willing to work to make dreams come true.